You're listening to the audio production of Ephesians Audio Lectures by Mark Roberts, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. These audio lectures are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Ephesians includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
Hello, my name is Mark Roberts, and I am excited to share with you what I believe to be one of the greatest treasures on earth. I'm speaking of the New Testament letter we call Ephesians. This letter is truly priceless in what it teaches and in its power to transform our lives. And I really do believe it's a great treasure. Now, I've spent much of the last 10 years of my life living with Ephesians, studying its language and history, wrestling with its compelling theology, being inspired by its cosmic vision. In addition to writing a commentary on Ephesians for the Story of God series, I've taught Ephesians in seminaries and churches, facing people's tough questions and learning from their striking insights. I've preached from Ephesians dozens of times, and I've written over 400 devotions on Ephesians for Life for Leaders, the daily digital devotional produced by Fuller's Max DePree Center for Leadership, where I work. Now, given how much of my life has been devoted to Ephesians, you may wonder if I'm getting just a little tired of it, perhaps even a little bored. In fact, the opposite is true. I'm more excited about this letter and its truth today than I was 10 years ago when I began my deep dive into Ephesians. And I'm hoping that soon you will share my excitement as we dig into this letter together. There is so much to learn, and so much more of God's grace to be experienced as we study Ephesians. And I really believe we need the message of this letter today. This video course is based on the commentary I wrote on Ephesians for the Story of God series. And indeed, the story of Ephesians is truly the story of God, a drama in which God is the primary actor, and the entire cosmos, the entire universe, is God's stage. God is also the primary author of this story, though, of course, it comes to us in human words. The story of Ephesians begins before creation and ends in eternity. God's story touches individual lives, to be sure, but it encompasses far more than just personal transformation. In Ephesians, God is gathering a people for himself and his purposes. He's building the church as the body of Christ and the temple of his Spirit. And through this church, that is, through us as a community, God is at work doing more than we could ever imagine so that the entire cosmos might see the glory of his gracious plan. According to this plan, God is uniting all things in heaven and on earth in Christ and restoring and renewing the whole creation. Now, the best introduction to Ephesians is reading through it. And if possible, I'd encourage you to do this in one sitting. There are 6 chapters, so that's a reasonable goal. And as you read, don't worry about the details yet. Rather, get a sense of the whole, its structure. Pay attention to common words and themes and images. And you can do that either right now, pause and do it, or you can do it after you finish watching this introduction. And by the way, one of an interesting way to sort of get Scripture in a different way and get Ephesians is to listen to it being read. There are some ways you can do that online for free, or you can always buy an audio version. But it's great to get a sense of the whole before we dig into the details. Now, as you read through Ephesians, you may be struck by some of the following. First, as I said, Ephesians is a story about God. The first 3 chapters especially focus on what God has done, beginning with creation and extending all the way to the age to come, all of time and history. Second, in this letter, Jesus Christ plays a co-starring role in God's drama. Again and again, God's activity in the world is said to be in Christ. In fact, the phrase in Christ or something equal to it appears 28 times throughout this letter. Third, As you read through Ephesians, you are struck by its lofty, intricate style. This letter contains some of the most complex sentences in the whole Bible. And in fact, one Greek sentence in the first chapter contains 202 words in Greek. It's the longest sentence in the Greek New Testament. Translating this sentence into English requires 8 sentences. Fourth, Ephesians is unique among the letters of Paul in the New Testament in that it doesn't reveal an obvious, specific historical setting in the life of some first century church. It's unlike Galatians, for example, where as you read Galatians, you realize there are these Judaizers, that is, Christians who are practicing Judaism, and you can make out the historic context, and then Paul writes specifically for that context. Ephesians speaks more broadly and generally to churches across the Roman Empire. Fifth, if you're familiar with Paul's other letters, you might be struck by what's not in Ephesians. For example, Ephesians does not speak about justification by faith, which is a giant theme in some of Paul's other writings. Rather, in this letter, Paul speaks of salvation by grace through faith, very similar to justification, but different. And clearly, Ephesians builds upon what Paul has written elsewhere, but developing new perspectives and new language to talk about it. At this point, we should pause to consider who wrote Ephesians. Now, that may seem obvious. The letter begins, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God. And later on, the third chapter, Paul will write, I, Paul, prisoner of Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. And then there's an autobiographical section. So Paul, apostle of the Gentiles, missionary, church planter, writer of so many New Testament documents, obviously he wrote Ephesians, yes? Case closed. Yet it's not closed for some Bible scholars. In fact, my first New Testament introduction class in college introduced me to a different way of thinking about the authorship of Ephesians. There are clearly in this letter differences in language and theology and style from some of what we find elsewhere in Paul's writings. And so my professor argued that Ephesians was written not by Paul himself, but rather by one of his disciples, one of his followers, who took Paul's theology, especially in Colossians, and wrote it for a new context and a new time. For many who say Paul didn't write this, they don't mean to deny its value or even its inspiration, but they see it as a way of a follower of Paul expanding upon his thought. Now, many years ago when I was a student, I was actually persuaded by that theory. It made sense to me. The differences in Ephesians seem to argue for a different author. But over time, I've come to believe differently. I've come to believe that, in fact, this was written by Paul. Partly the arguments for the authorship of someone other than Paul just didn't seem convincing to me. There are differences between Ephesians and other writings of Paul, and yet they're understandable. Plus, in my own experience as a preacher and a theologian and a writer and a teacher, I found a couple things to be true. One is I speak differently in different contexts. I speak differently right here today than if I were speaking, for example, in an academic context. Or this would be different if this were a children's sermon. So my style varies. And also, over the years, I've come to have new insights using new language. And so there's development and growth. And it makes sense to me that that would have happened with Paul as well. So I affirm the authorship of Paul and we'll assume that as we go forward. I think it makes the most sense. Now, the other thing we need to consider about any letter is its historical context and for whom it was written and why. This is actually trickier about Ephesians than it might first appear. Again, it says right at the beginning, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God to God's holy people in Ephesus. You say, okay, that's simple enough. It was written to the church in Ephesus. But some of your Bibles will have a little footnote by Ephesus that will say something like, in Ephesus is missing from some of the earliest biblical manuscripts, including the very oldest manuscript we have of Ephesians, known as Papyrus 46. Doesn't say in Ephesus. And of course, this has led to lots of scholarly theories. I won't go into them all here, but the one that makes the most sense to me is that Paul wrote this letter not to one particular church, as he usually did, but actually to several churches in Asia Minor. That's modern-day Turkey, Western Turkey. That this was really a what we might call a circular letter meant to be read in different churches, and literally there is a blank left in the original, where we have in Ephesus it was a blank, so that when this letter was read, the reader, who, by the way, is identified later in Ephesians as someone named Tychicus, where the reader could fill in the name of the city or town where this was being read. Now, as it turns out, many of the manuscripts we have available to us today, the ancient Greek manuscripts, have in Ephesus. That copy worked. But we also have some of the other manuscripts, which is why there's this unusual blank. This circular letter theory makes sense not only because we're missing in Ephesus, but also because of the lack of specifics about a particular community. This is, as we read through, you'll see Paul is not referring to details or people in Ephesus. It's a broader kind of communication. In fact, one could argue this is the broadest vision of God's work in all of Paul's writings. It's like Colossians, but more expansive and more universal, more exalted in style. The basic structure of Ephesians is really quite straightforward. There are six chapters. The first three focus on, you might say, theology. The last three focus on living it out, living the story, as we say. Chapters 1 to 3 tell the story of God's work in Christ throughout the world, throughout the cosmos. It's theological. Human beings appear mainly as those who receive God's grace, and they're only hints of what is yet to come for us. Then chapters 4 to 6 take the story of God in chapters 1 to 3 and spell out the implications for us, for our calling, our ministry, our actions, our speech. It gets into many of the details of how we live. One of the things that is striking about Ephesians is how important the church is in this letter. That we who are Christian are not just individually connected to Christ, but through Christ we're part of the church, the body of Christ. You see this in the original language, for example, in chapter 2. The togetherness that we have in Christ is actually emphasized in a bunch of very unusual and rare Greek verbs that are translated this way in English. It says, God made us alive together in Christ. And then God raised us together with Christ. All these from chapter 2. God seated us together with Christ. We're citizens together with the saints. We are joined together with other parts of God's building. We're being built together with other parts of God's building. In other words, the very language is emphasizing our togetherness, our unity in Christ as the church. And the church is central to God's whole plan for the whole cosmos. We see that in Ephesians 3. And then in Ephesians 4, there's an emphasis upon the unity of God's people in Christ. And we'll get to that later on. But there's a reason for this emphasis on unity, and that is, we go back to the first chapter, we see that God has this amazing plan to bring, as it says, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth in Christ. And so in chapter 2, the cross of Christ actually brings unity among divided peoples. And in chapter 3, the unity of the church bears witness to the whole cosmos that God's plan is working. Chapter 4 urges us to make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. And then what follows in the letter shows us how we can live that out. So Ephesians will speak to you as an individual, but also be sure to hear it as it speaks to you all, as we would say in California, or sometimes just you guys. You know, I used to live in Texas. We'd say Ephesians speaks to all y'all. If any of you are from parts of New Jersey, it's used guys.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.